All right. So if no one has anything to ask while they're looking over these books on the table,
Lucas, I do have one.
Okay.
Now I have my notes up, finally reading through them. So we know of two meteors, the green and the yellow. Has there been any sign? This denotes a black corruption, a third jewel, black. Have there been any signs of a third meteor?
Third meteor, we have not had any news or heard any rumors of a third meteor.
Okay. That's worrisome, but all right.
I mean, your concerns are founded, being as these apparent two gems, or cores as you call them, have sprung from both these meteors that have landed in this world. So it is not too far-fetched to assume that we should be expecting a third.
That was my thinking, yes.
Oh boy.
Hopefully the third one doesn't bring anything bad and just brings us one of Dahlia's friends.
Didn't you say it was called the Black Corruption?
Yeah, that's...
sound good.
I was trying to be hopeful, but...
Oh, that's new for you.
Yeah, you're right. I'm sorry.
So as you guys are discussing that, Lucas, you feel a vibration in your person?
All right. Lucas will pull it out. Johan?
Son.
He can't get through it. Giggles.
I heard the static, right? Like all
yes.
that still.
Yes, okay. Yes. Son, is that you?
Father?
It is so good to hear from you.
Good to hear from you too.
I ran into Johan on the way to Embermorn. And he gave me your reports.
Excellent. Have you had much opportunity to read through them at this point, or?
I did. It seems that you have been quite busy since your deployment to Vicland.
Very much so. Things aren't especially great over here on the western coast right now.
I assume, or I'm hopeful, that you are not traveling alone.
No, I have a party of a fairly reliable people with me, so we're working through the problems as best we can.
Are they trustworthy? Do you trust them?
They haven't given me any reason not to at this point.
That's good. Did you have any new findings that you did not include in your report?
As a matter of fact, we just came across one. The meteors that have struck Victim and Aletheia recently, the one from Aletheia several decades ago. We found a link to a potential interplanar threat. Still looking into it, though.
You mentioned something about meteors in Aletheia.
Yes, there was one that landed there, trying to remember, some time ago. And then the one that recently struck that I gave in my report in the Elding Bowl.
Interesting.
You have no knowledge of the one? I would assume you would.
Yes, the one in Aletheia we do have knowledge of. As a matter of fact, I had arrived in Embermorn earlier in the day. And we were collecting artifacts and others to transport to the Blackfront Temple for analysis and research. Among those were sealed coffins, sealed fae coffins from Rhiannach, some old scrolls written in Draconic from the Sindar Isles, and a few meteor pieces from Aletheia, confiscated from some black market dealers.
More on the black market. Okay. We did come across an individual here that was dealing in the black market gems.
It seems that that's where it's most commonly found.
Yes. The gems appear to open... it could just be coincidence based off what this person was doing, but we believe the gems opened a portal to some other plane. We got kind of sucked into it. Dealt with the problem inside, but it wasn't that great. So it was some kind of slime monster. I couldn't tell you what specifically the being was inside of the portal.
It does sound like you have been keeping busy,
to say the least.
Now, the meteor in the that landed in Vicklin that you mentioned, did you have any contact with it? Did you find anything of note?
I did. As they reported, it had mind control properties, and also we got a hold of its core. Its core awoken, and an individual was trapped inside of it.
An individual was trapped inside of this core, you say?
Yes. She's currently a member of my party, oddly enough. And we just discovered that she is... Her homeworld is from Nilfheim. She refers to it as not Astrod, but on the world tree, it's Nilfheim.
This is very interesting news that you have come across. Do you think that that artifact is something worthy to be looked at or maybe locked up? It could be quite dangerous. If what you say is true, of course.
Potentially, she could be dangerous. I mean, the artifact is an individual. I will keep an eye on her, but at this point in time, she hasn't shown any sort of hostility. As a matter of fact, she seems rather distraught over the current state of her sisters.
And you believe these tales that they've been feeding you? Talks of Niflheim and other Viclandian worlds, it's chalked up to nothing but fairy tales and myth.
I mean, we lock up fairy tales and myth, Father. Everything's worth investigating to some degree. I know what I saw. I know what this person is doing, so... You know.
But keep your eyes open and... Remember what I've taught you. Don't trust just anybody.
I understand. We just...
Johan also... Oh, I understand. Being that Johan was not sent with you. I had an audience with Commander Riggs. To see what was going on with him. Johan seemed very concerned.
I did get that feeling from him.
He looked no worse for wear. Seemed like it was just us getting old, glory days being behind us and all. He assured me everything was fine and that he was just under the weather.
Interesting choice of words. Did the book that they secured... What has come of it?
Well, the artifact or book that Johan was telling me about was nothing more than an old book, a mundane book of dwarven runes that were translated as fairly commonly known dwarven history.
Okay.
I did not see anything suspicious or anything worthy to be locked up in a vault, despite Johann's predispositions. He did insist that that is not the book that he saw. But who knows?
Well, to be truthful, Father, I would hope that you would know.
From the book that was presented to me, it looked nothing of what was described to me. I can look into it further.
That would be my recommendation. We don't need the artifacts that I've seen out here. We don't need artifacts of that power running around unchecked inside of Rooke, let alone inside of one of the temples. And I'm concerned.
I am aware. I will find out if this book is what he says it is, and if it is the correct book that was presented to me. Johann also told me that you too had found an artifact or a book.
Yes, it's included in my report, the details of what we found in the research done by the Silver Circle into its potential purpose, although it was limited at best.
Do you think it had anything to do with that strange storm that passed through here not that long ago? Fastest storm I've ever seen.
This particular book, no. As a matter of fact, I experienced the effects of this book rather explicitly. This one seems to affect twilight and darkness. Very early on in the expedition, we encountered region-wide, I don't even know what I would call it, would just call it region-wide darkness that induced fairly negative visions. This book is terrifying.
How many people know about this book?
Currently my party.
I would keep it secret from everyone else. I will request that Johann be deployed and that he retrieve that book from you and bring it back to Rooke as soon as possible.
Okay. I'm preparing a container for shipment. I've got some people working on building it, and once it's done, I will place the seal on it as soon as it's available so that we can actually transport it safely.
Where will I tell Johann to find you?
Edhelon is where I will be returning to at some point.
I will request his departure immediately.
Thank you, Father.
Is there anything else you would like to tell me?
He's actually... Lucas is looking around the room right now. He's looking at, like, shit that's on the table. He's looking particularly at the teleportation circle in the center. Is any of it something he recognizes? Something that he uses for his job, basically?
No, probably not, because what they're using is Seder slash, you know, Viklandian magic and runes. Unless you have come across that something like that before in your past.
No, I wouldn't.
Yeah, nothing in this room would ring any bells to Lucas.
Okay. Nothing else. I am seeking assistance from a pair of local scholars to get more information onto the current happenings in the Underthorn, trying to piece together what this puzzle is. And that's about where we stand.
Okay. Well, I will further inquire with Commander Riggs about this so-called book and find out more. I leave for Blackfront tonight with the artifacts mentioned before. And remember, keep what you have secret and be careful who you trust.
Understood. Again, it's good to hear your voice, Father.
It is good to hear from you too. And then the connection cuts.
Okay. Can you send me the Niam with the things?
The what?
With the things he listed.
Oh. Yeah.
Lucas has hung up the phone and puts it back in his pouch.
Snapped it up.
Yeah. And I guess he'll return to poring over the documents.
Okay.
I want to know what you two think of all this stuff that we just uncovered. You scholarly types. You should be freaking out of your minds about all this, right?
We've been writing down everything that you have been telling us.
Yeah, but what do you think about it?
I think it is absolutely amazing what has been transpiring in our world. We have myths and legends coming to life. We have a return of probably a Valkyrie. They have been extinct for generations.
So you believe all of this?
Of course. There is some truth to some myths. There is some history tied to mythology and legend.
You really think I'm a Valkyrie?
It could may as well be very possible. You say you came from... And he sort of points his finger to your amber core. You said you came out of that and the meteor came from the sky, and then the books that we found, the pages, it must be more than a convenient coincidence.
I just have more questions. I just don't even know how to put them into words.
You all look pretty dumbfounded.
It's the quietest you guys have ever been.
Glug glugs.
Are you sure you should be thanking them just a moment?
I'm fine.
You don't sound fine.
That's mean. I'm only a little more nasally. It's not that big of a deal.
You still haven't even figured out if you're of age.
What does age matter?
Rhiann's gonna put a finger up in front of her eyes and that.
Her eyes like vastly slide over the finger to both sides.
I am a little concerned.
I'm going to attempt to lift the bottle gently from her fingers.
Hey! Little gremlin fingers clutch it to her, like, staring blank-eyed in front of her.
Blank-eyed. Closing dexterity checks.
This will go very well.
Spring.
Do I do strength or dex?
You're trying to hold it from him?
Strength. Yeah, I'm trying to hold it.
Wow.
You have
You
have a grip on that flask.
That's grip. Don't you dare.
That's rather impressive, honestly.
A little terrifying.
Just don't. It's been a long week. Leave it be.
Do you have a problem?
No.
That sounds like someone with a problem.
Do you have a problem?
Many.
Well, then we're on the same page.
So you do have a problem?
Yes. But also, Not really. Just leave me alone and keep looking dumbfounded around the room. And she'll like grumble and turn towards a corner with her booze.
He's alright. I will keep an eye on her.
Well, just make sure all your hands stay attached. She looks like she might bite them off.
I will do my best.
Skvall turns to Arnie. I believe he pulled you to the side earlier.
Mm-hmm.
Please tell me more about this encounter that you had with a Nidhogg. Or suppose it's Nidhogg.
I mean, don't know that's that what it was. It was just a big eye up, you know, in a different plane, and it was draining the world of life, basically.
Do you remember what the plane looked like?
It was like it was above the world. I was more focused on the giant eye speaking.
And did this eye do anything? Was there a body to it? Was it...
No, I mean, it had like black tendrils that came down from it, but they weren't like physical.
And he like saunters over to the table and picks up the book and points to the crown of jewels. Did it have any of these? And he points to the emerald sort of looking circle, the amber circle, and the diamond.
Well, Marin doesn't remember, does Arnie?
During that encounter, you did not see any of those. You only saw the five books.
Okay. No crown of anything. I mean, there's so many planes and other worlds connected, you could just run forever. We don't know what that eye was.
This is very true. And how did you say you encountered this, or how did you say you came to this plane?
When we were, I believe we told you about how we know about the second meteor.
Yes.
With the green gems.
Yes.
It's when we went through the portal that was made out of the green gems.
And it was just you. None of the rest of your party saw this.
No.
We just got immediately injected into the slime room.
Hmm.
To be fair, it's not the first time I've had a run-in with it.
That was my next question. Do you have a history of this?
A slight history.
How long of it? Since childhood? Since...
Yeah.
And you've seen this eye before?
A few times.
And you see him furiously jotting things down.
But it doesn't necessarily mean anything.
It might not. If this is something that is part of your life history, it might mean something.
It just comes with the specialty.
The specialty?
You know, working with the planes and things like that. You tend to run into things sometimes. It's pretty normal.
It is pretty normal if you normally work with planes, but that is a rare skill in this world. Where did you say you were from?
I didn't.
Very curious. Corvain sort of comes over to where the party is standing. Well, I hope our resources were enough maybe to answer some questions. Is there anything else you might have for us?
Aside from the million more questions that you left us with?
We are here to answer as much as we can.
I have a question.
Yes.
I just find this so hard to believe. Could it be possible I was a prisoner? Maybe I'm not a Valkyrie at all.
Yeah, that, maybe this is all just a convenient cover based on your mythology.
That is completely possible.
I'd love to believe that that's me and my sisters, but I just don't know. You're gonna see Dahlia's eyes start to well up and she kind of swallows the tears back down.
It is completely possible that this... We could all be wrong about this, but we cannot deny the connections that were uncovered.
Wouldn't a Valkyrie be incredibly powerful?
Of course. They were chosen warriors of Odin.
It's just so hard to believe. I don't know what to think.
And you said you had sisters. What are their names?
Oh my god, I have to find them. Hold on.
No.
As Dahlia is pondering the names of her sisters, as the memories begin coming back, Torvain turns to Lucas. So what are your next moves? Is there anything that we can assist you with?
I believe we're headed to Svahavn next, although we have to further discuss that. Regarding incidents that have happened there recently, do you know anything about potentially people unexplainingly dropping dead?
In Svahavn?
In Svahavn specifically, yes.
I have not heard of any such news.
Okay.
Where did you hear this?
We encountered an individual that was cursed, and he said the origin of his curse was in Svahavn. Or at least we assume he was cursed. The curse appears to be behaving like a disease. I don't know if you have any information on those types of magics.
I'm afraid I do not... And this person, how did he come across this disease or curse, as you say?
Touch. As best that he could articulate it to us. He's a bit emotional and wasn't the greatest at relaying things.
I mean, there are many curses and diseases that are transmitted through touch. Many so dropping dead. If it is something more specific than that, I could look into it for you.
Visions of shadows trying to hunt you.
This is something I have not heard. This is not something I have heard before.
All right.
I remember. You're gonna see like Dahlia's eyes just widen. I remember my sister's names, but it's not the same names that's in this paper here. Sister's names were Evnari and Mezzeldris. We also had another sister. She was much younger though. I barely remember her. She was maybe 5 or 6. Her name was Ivana, but she's not anywhere in here.
Evnari and Mezzeldris, you say?
Yes.
And your name is Dahlia?
Yes.
Could these writings may have mistaken them for Livy and Magnahilt? And Dagna?
It It's quite possible if it's thousands of years old.
Things written through time tend to get muddled, depending on who is telling the story.
I have nothing but more questions. We used to call her Levy. Levy, Livy, they're so similar.
Again, this could all be coincidence, but we cannot ignore the connections.
Dahlia's gonna look around the room. What are you all thinking? Am I crazy? Am I mad? Have I lost it?
I don't think that someone in your situation would be considered mad for looking at something like this and finding a correlation.
Yeah, correlation there may be doesn't necessarily mean causation.
I don't know what I want more. If I want this to be true or if I don't. I'm not sure.
Well, being a true, doesn't that mean your sisters are dead?
Or they're in the cores. She was in a core. What if the other core is one of her sisters? And what if the third core is another one?
Was there a core ever recovered from the other meteor?
Not that we know of. Everything was mined dry.
We could try to check the black markets to see if there's any other ones out there.
You'd be paying some good coin for that information.
I know.
Especially if it's a whole core.
All I know is I'd rather them be dead than be in the black corruption.
Well, your particular core wasn't the nicest either, and you're alive and seem okay, unless you are. I don't know what you might be.
Dahlia's eyes are gonna widen at him. Do you think there's black corruption in me?
I was more concerned about you randomly attempting to mind control all of us, to be honest.
Dali is going to cast Prestidigitation again and just throw a little glitter at him.
Personally, I think Dahlia would cry if she accidentally stepped on a flower, so I think we're fine.
Yeah, I mean, that's the impression that I'm getting, so I'm not particularly worried right now regarding if the individual inside is evil. I mean, the core definitely is.
Was it evil, or was it just trying to protect itself, though?
Debatable.
I mean, there are parasitic insects in nature that do something similar in nature.
True, but based off the written history here, we have
history or wild myth.
True.
I mean, do you guys all remember when we first met? When I came out of the orb, I was incredibly angry, but it quickly faded. I don't know if that means anything. Probably just what was left over from the orb.
Escavalt sort of chimes in. Well, whatever the case may be, it is good that this core is here and the other jewels are not anywhere close. As he points to the lines of the pages, it seems that if they are brought together, it awakens Nidhogg.
In what fashion? Would he just destroy the world?
That it seems that is how he is called, and it seems that that is how he was called to destroy Niflheim, or Nilestrand, how you call it.
Well, then in that case, we're definitely not going to the other meteor. Last thing we need is that.
Things things have a funny way of creeping up on you when you try to avoid them.
True. True. I just don't like the alternatives. So and
things usually born together usually find a way to find each other again.
Something, something, doo-doo-doo, fate.
I wouldn't exactly call it that.
Life, finds a way.
You fucking bastard.
Knew it.
But it also would not be wise to ignore the fact that another of these cores is on this world.
Possibly.
Dahlia, what do you feel when you think about your sisters?
Well, I don't feel much, actually. I feel like if they were here on this plane, I would feel some type of connection to them. We were so close. My youngest sister, Ivana, she was so much younger, so I barely remember her. But Ezeldris and Levi were incredibly close. I feel like I would feel them if they were here anyway.
Perhaps you would not feel them, but how do you feel about them?
Elf.
You miss them?
She doesn't know how to respond.
Do you miss your sisters?
I miss what I know, but if any of them are in a black corruption, they're not my sisters anymore.
Well, there is a chance. There is a chance that they may yet still be themselves if you came out relatively unscathed. Then there may be hope that they might be relatively unscathed as well.
In all of your research, do you know if there's anything that we could do to... She just stops talking.
I would say be cautious if you were to pursue these jewels. I would, and he points to Dahlia, I would stay away if you do indeed find either of these jewels.
What if we found one and destroyed it? Wouldn't that eliminate the problem?
Indeed it would.
We don't know what that would do. If you've got a jewel that's capable of summoning a...
Well, but you need all three to summon. Let's say you only have two together and you destroy one. Now all three can never be together.
Yeah, it's always dangerous just destroying something like that. You never really know.
You don't
never
just
really
go to
know
a
what it
big
does.
Field.
I once read a story of something like this happening where there were 9 rings and
get out. Leave. I knew it. From the tone of your voice, like he's gonna say something cheesy. He's good in the
wet, isn't he? I think there's one question that I have.
Of course.
Why wasn't I destroyed? How would I survive? If the orb was destroyed, why did I survive it?
Well, the orb was not destroyed.
Oh. It's now embedded in my chest, but... How did I survive? I don't understand.
Perhaps it was meant to survive. To find another world for Nidhogg to consume.
It just gets more and more awful as I ask more questions.
It really does.
From a technical standpoint, there are other planes and dimensions where if you enter them, you don't age, need to eat, drink, or even breathe.
Sounds like what happened to me, I guess.
Now let me ask you this, while you're in the core, what do you see? What do you feel? Is there anything in the core perhaps you can tell us that may help?
I used to see a lot of colors, like fragmented dreams and sometimes nightmares. Sometimes I would see these floating faces screaming, but I couldn't hear anything. And when I would try and reach out to talk to them or touch them, it would just melt away.
Shades of your past, possibly. Is there anything else that you may have seen during your time in this orb?
Sometimes I would have dreams of my mother and my father, but at this point I can't even remember what they look like. I just knew it was them by the feeling that I would get. But mostly just color, random faces.
Were you sometimes able to feel or see the other jewels during your time in the core?
Sometimes it would feel like I was floating, and I would feel like a pull in a certain direction. When I would try to go in that direction, I would be pushed back. Would that mean anything?
It could mean many things. It could mean the influence of whatever being has control over these jewels.
I so badly want to believe that it's my sisters, but I'm also really scared if it is them, because I don't know what we'll be getting involved in.
As I said, proceed with caution if you were to pursue this orb or the other jewels.
Lucas, you've handled a lot of dark things in your work, and Arnie, you know of portals. What do you think we should do?
If we have reason to believe that you have the potential to join with the other cores and summon a god, we need to avoid it. Because if you attempt that, there are forces that will do everything they can to stop you, and that's not a place you want to go.
So, if we are to, let's say there are these orbs, and let's say my sisters are trapped in them, or not, if we are to leave them, nothing can cause the black corruption unless the three of us come contact, right?
I think that first we need to find them and research them independently, and then determine what to do with them. Like, the fact that you're here is already, you know, it is what it is. As for the others, whatever fate awaits them, they're gonna have to find out independently.
I love my sisters. I love them with all my heart, but I don't want to destroy the world in my efforts to find them.
Well, as a denizen of this world, I appreciate that, and I'm sure the others in the room do as well.
And we can always have, you know, plan B for if we accidentally find one.
I think plan B is a good idea, because I'm out of ideas.
Don't worry, I've always got a plan B.
As long as we're not going through any portals, I'm all right.
We wouldn't be going through any portals.
We did once, I think. I'm gonna see once. Her kind of smirk.
Well, being that our resources are limited here, perhaps my superior can offer more assistance. She may be well versed in these sorts of things and maybe point you in the correct direction.
Who would that be?
It would be Gudrun the High Seeress Gudrun Bjorndotter in Wintermaw. She is the head of the Cider Academy.
Cider?
S-E-I-D-R.
Oh.
How far is that travel from here?
It is quite a ways away. It is in the northern tip of Vicland.
And what time is it right now? Sorry, asking for roleplay.
It is, I believe, 7 a.m.?
Oh, whoa. And I never imagine the time that it actually is. I always think it's another time.
I thought you were going to say p.m.
Me too.
You arrived early in the morning, and you began your research around 3 a.m.
Damn.
These guys have not slept yet, basically.
Yes, seriously.
We took a nap in the afternoon.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Well, what are you all thinking? I mean, it's early, but I don't know.
I mean, we could always finish the trek to Svahavn, see if anyone made it from the Dragonfire.
I think that's a good next step, and maybe we can check up and see if there's any happenings related to our friend Viorik.
And if not, we can head west and follow the other tracks.
Good idea.
Yeah. I believe you said the dragon nest was in the town of
Grimwick,
yeah. So
nearby.
Well, if you are going to Svahavn next, speak to my sister. She is the Jarl, newly elected Jarl of Svahavn. Her name is Farallyn Frostward. Now note, I have not been in contact with her for years. She believes me dead or missing.
Would it be upsetting if we were to tell her otherwise?
I would advise not. We have had a rough family history.
So don't tell her we know you.
No.
Got it.
I won't ask questions.
A word of advice for that the next time. Just mention you know the Jarl. Not that it's a sister. We'll do our best.
Oh, sorry, Lucas.
That's okay.
Rhiann?
Yes?
Is Batlak awake over there? She's not looking too good.
Batlak is actually current... Not Batlak. I don't, are you talking about Batlak or Lilac?
Oh, I don't know. What's wrong? No, I'm Lak.
I assume the bat is not the one drinking.
The bat is not the one drinking, although you have noticed it has been very... If a bat can fly drunkenly, it has been drunkenly waddling from wall to wall.
Yes. Which bats can get drunk when they eat fermented fruit.
That's why I was thinking that it was Batlak. So I'm like, I can imagine a bat floating around just like...
Exactly. They're both very wobbly. Although you will notice, Dahlia, that Gnomelak, the bat's kind of wobbling around in the air, but Gnomelak sitting in her chair at the table and clutching her booze bottle is currently staring very intently at you.
Hmm.
And has been for the last hour or so.
I believe she is a bit grumpy. But otherwise, I assume she was okay.
Grumpy?
Are you not?
Do I look grumpy?
Yes.
Dumps and lots look.
Galak, why don't we get some water in your body before we leave?
I'm fine. I want to know if you're fine, Mrs. I just learned that I could possibly end the world, but I'm totally fine with it. You don't look okay.
I don't really have an answer, my love, but here we are.
And you! She'll veer over and stare at Lucas and Arnie, and honestly everybody else in the room, kind of hazily, not really focusing on anyone. I can smell it on all of you. Don't you pretend like you're not scared.
I mean, I think you're just smelling the alcohol, but...
Yeah, the bottle's right under your nose.
It's a very similar smell, okay?
Really?
Beer and alcohol.
But still...
Lilac, I won't hurt you, I promise.
I didn't say I was afraid. And she'll actually smile a little creepily at you. And then she'll look back at Lucas and Arnie. But you! I can see it under all the time to go get shit done facade. You're thinking things and you're not saying them.
That's how thinking works.
That is not always.
I am not especially concerned about the fate of the world. I just want to make sure our friend's okay. He'll say that fairly sternly.
She narrows her eyes and then nods acceptably.
That's what I wanted to hear. Or more of what Dahlia probably wanted to hear.
I don't know, and she'll rub one eye and then, like, slump over.
There she goes.
You are free to rest here for as long as you'd like.
I'm tired, but I can still make travel. Do you guys want to rest, or do you want to start heading out?
With that dragon around, I don't feel comfortable staying in one place.
Fair.
Onwards!
Rhiann, Lucas?
I mean, we just started our day, so I'm good to continue. And I'm sure these gentlemen would appreciate a night's rest. It's been exciting, but...
Exhausting.
There is no way we can rest now with the information that we have just received.
Nerds.
I understand completely. Rhiann, are you all right to go?
I'm good to get out of these good sirs here.
Thank you both so much for letting me research all of this. I really, really appreciate it.
You are most welcome.
Dahlia's gonna bow her head in thanks and step out the front door.
You know where the tower is. If you need any further assistance or a place to stay, you are more than welcome.
Well, thank you very much. Hopefully we don't come back bringing any dreadful news and we only ever come back with happy things.
I'm sure you'll do fine.
That was very encouraging.
You're doing your best. Okay, so are you guys heading to Svahavn? It's not that long of a walk. It's like 4 hours.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's not for long for Dahlia, but Kai would be like, F that.
It's ridiculous.
Yeah. Where's the train?
All right. So you leave the tower. You say your goodbyes to Torvain and Iskvald and your thanks. And you start making your way south. Through the rest of the Kveldsjarna Forest to the town of Svahavn. During your walk, if you would like to speak about anything.
A wolf in the shape of a dog. A wolf in the shape of a dog just climbed on my lap.
That's exactly the vibe.
And no, they didn't even notice us leave. They just kept researching.
they sort of just bowed and continued looking and writing.
The paper's all over.
Yeah.
Didn't even notice Gnomelak smuggle out the booze.
No. Bad.
Well, Rukok's not here, so we have to have a drunk.
Someone needs to be
someone
drunk.
Someone has to be the comedic drunk relief.
Well, he's not doing it anymore, so...
Yeah, he won't even do it when he is here.
Oh, yeah, but every week it's different. He's either like, oh, I'm a gentleman, and then the next week he's like, oh, I'm a drunk. And I'm like, which one are you?
He's both. He's very dynamic.
He's the Black Jim. No.
Yeah, right? Oh, my God.
The whole time.
He's your sister.
He's your sister.
Oh, God.
If he shows up in drag in the next episode,
that will be on brand.
Would actually not surprise anyone.
Siltris, you're so strong.
What did you roll, Arnie? You rolled a 3?
I did.
Here we go.
Alright, so you travel through the woods. It's a 4-hour trek to Svahavn. And you arrive at the town gates. No further issue.
Ha! I distrust X. X.
Alright, so as you approach the gates of Svahavn, you see that it is nestled at the edge of the forest, surrounded by a wooden sort of palisade with buildings set atop hills and other various forest terrain.
Forest tiles. Ooh.
Ooh. Hey. Pretty.
This is all custom made art.
Yes.
Yes.
Right?
Drawn with mouse.
Yep. With your mouse. 10 out of 10.
All right. So you approach the town gates. You can see two guards at the main gate. They're draped in the colors of Svahavn, which is green and white. Green representing the forest and white representing the plains and beaches to the south of Svahavn. So you walk in. What do you guys do?
Is there like a town crier doing anything, or
is there anything going on?
There is no town crier. You can see that. You can see most of the people are working in sort of the lumber mill area of the town. Other townsfolk are, you know, setting up shop. Or standing behind carts. It's a smaller town than Edheland. So something like this would not have a town crier or, you know, anything to that extent.
It's like a work site, basically.
Yeah.
Oh, so it's like Riverwood in Skyrim.
It's more of like a lumber town.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, think of Riverwood.
Immediately transported.
Literally.
Suddenly, a dragon!
Foos rode up.
Skyrim PTSD.
Yeah.
The number.
Arnie's gonna try and talk to one of the guards at the gate.
Okay, so as you approach, the guard nods at you.
Hey there. So, besides us, has anyone you don't know, someone unfamiliar, someone strange, or a group of strange people, possibly covered in soot, come this way recently?
I mean, there are many people that come through these gates. We did have a few that claim to have been attacked by a dragon. They are currently at the inn, recovering.
Were there any children with them?
There are many children that come through these gates.
With the group that was attacked by the dragon, specifically?
No. I did not see them with child.
Okay, okay. Good talk, thanks. She's just gonna walk away.
Fucking, anyway. Lucas will nod and chase after her. Like, he'll, like, nod thanks and chase after her. I'm assuming you're walking towards the inn?
Yeah.
Okay.
Lilac will stick her tongue out at the guard.
Lilac is a vibe.
What does this guard do? She, like, shrugs as she gets, like, walk in.
She came to me and asked about strange people, but the only strange person I met today was her.
You're right. Thank you for the exact vibe I was going for.
All right. So as you walk throughout the small-ish town, you can see a building, a large wooden single-story building with a green roof and a small vegetable garden laid out up front. You can see a sign in the front called the Long Oak Tavern and Inn, since they are one and the same in Dungeons & Dragons. upon entering, the room splits into two wings. On the left is a small tavern. On the right are where about... You can see three doors are available. The, One of the workers of this tavern approaches you. Oh, how can I help you?
Yeah, where would we find the, dragon attack survivors?
Ah, they are currently resting in... And she points to the door on the left.
Ah, thank you. She's gonna go to the door.
Alright.
And is it open?
The door is currently closed.
Can she open it?
You can, it's not locked.
Okay.
So in the room, as you open the door, you can see one person laying on the bed and two laying on the ground. Their clothes look fairly tattered and covered with soot. They look fairly injured, but not gravely. You can see scratches and other minor injuries on their person.
Are they awake?
They're sleeping. They didn't react to the door opening.
Lilac?
Yeah?
Would you do what you do best?
What now?
Would you do what you do best and make a commotion?
Yeah, sure. And she'll just immediately whip around to the main room, having no idea what you meant, no. And just yell, "All right, who runs this here joint?"
The person that was just speaking to Arnie. Now. How can I be of service? There's no need to yell.
She'll point one little finger at the open door and go, "Do you see the state of these here peoples? This is no way to treat gravely injured humans."
They came looking for her room. It is not my responsibility to treat wounded. It is not what our specialty is.
She stomps her foot. "I demand better service."
Do you know them?
She'll look dumbfounded at Arnie.
Arnie's shaking her head no. And doing the X motion with her hands.
She'll see that, take it in with a quick nod, and then turn back around and go, "Oh, no, whoops, sorry, wrong people. I was looking in the wrong room. Don't mind us, that's, yep, nope. Bye."
She sort of nods very confusedly and continues whatever she's doing, folding towels, I guess. I don't know.
We're continuing this chain of being weird ass people in this town.
Lucas will just go in and see. He said they're not super bad off, right?
No. Minor scratches and minor injuries, nothing grave. Like, there's no, like, they're not, like, bleeding out.
Yeah.
They look like cultists?
Yeah.
You can't tell by the clothes they're wearing. They're wearing common, tattered, soot-covered clothes.
Lucas will wake, will go to the one that, I don't know, looks the eldest. And, wake them up.
As soon as you shake.
Very gently. As a doctor with a bedside manner.
As you gently shake the one on the bed, the one that looks the oldest to you, he sort of slowly begins opening his eyes and is startled at the sight of these people in his room. What?
Calm, sir. Sorry. I was told that there were injured, and I'm just here to check on everybody and make sure everybody's okay. I'm a doctor, so I'm just looking y'all over real quick. Sorry to startle you.
Where did you? We didn't request a doctor. Who are you?
There was a guard at the gate was concerned about you. He saw you come in and just wanted someone to check on you.
Make a deception check.
Maybe.
The guard at the gate, he didn't even pay us any attention when we were walking by. I mean,
you understand, they have to keep a vigil, and when there's injured walking into town, you know, that does raise concern.
I guess that makes sense, I mean, with what we've been through.
I mean, what happened to end you in this state? It doesn't look terribly bad, but I don't like seeing burns.
We were fortunate enough to get out before the worst of it. Of course, we were still caught in the dragon fire, but not as bad as the other prisoners. And he shows you, like, his wrists, and you can see that there are, you know, burn marks from rope on his wrists.
Prisoners? What was happening? Like, why were you prisoners? What were they doing?
Something about making loads of money for ransom, and I don't know. They were very strange. You know, we heard rumors of this cult during our travel, and we tried to be as careful as we could while traveling, but they didn't seem like the cult type.
What do you mean by that?
Insight check on this peasant.
Insight check.
Peasants.
What are you, classes now? What's going on here?
Oh, never mind.
No. I mean, from you don't sense any sort of intonation in his voice that would lead you to not believe what he's saying, but
he is completely telling the truth.
You can think what you're thinking. You can't put a finger on if what you're thinking is true.
I mean, Lucas can confirm that those are actual rope burn marks. Like, that's not a question to him, correct?
Mm-hmm.
All right.
And the other two sort of slowly wake up and, whoa, what is going on? Who are these people? Nilo. It's okay. It's okay, Ragda. They're here to help. Apparently the guard in the front really did care, and he sent us a doctor.
And Lucas will start, like, looking, excuse me one moment, and he'll start looking at her injuries to see if everything's okay. Yeah. Clearly it is, but he's doing the motions.
Yeah, so they're freely giving you, you know, whatever you request of their bodies to check out.
The, wow.
Okay. Okay.
Phrasing.
He's phrasing. A doctor with good bedside manner.
like you go and reach for their arm and there's no struggle there. Like yeah. they give you their arms and they let you no check them struggle. Out. Okay.
I consent, doctor.
Oh god.
I mean, we are RPing.
And in that point,
anytime Lucas tries to be a good person, we just yeah. ruin it over it.
He's just shaking his head. He can hear the snickering in the background. No.
Well, I wanted to say when he was reassuring his fellow inmates, not inmates, sorry, in groupies. Whatever, that they were okay and there was a doctor looking after them. Lilac over everyone's shoulders is just grinning creepily at all of them. Alrighty. You know, to add to the effect.
Yep. Yes. No one sees.
We're here to help.
There's a doctor and five random people.
We're here now.
We're just filling the doorway.
Okay, the two on the floor don't see because they're sort of younger, but the one on the bed sort of peeks over Lucas's shoulder as he's examining her. Him, sorry. And he catches a glimpse of Lilac. Grinning. What's her problem? Why is she smiling like that?
Oh, our friend over there, the gnome friend? Oh, you'll have to excuse her. She's unable to see and doesn't really know what to do with her face.
Exactly. That's exactly the vibe.
I see. It's, I mean, if you could tell her to maybe not grin in this direction, it would comfort me a little bit more. It's a little creepy.
Sir, I don't think she knows what direction anything is.
That seems a little bit rude, wouldn't you say?
Yes, we do need to be, you know, I understand your concern. But fear not, she's just, you know, we try not to bring too much to attention to her disabilities, sir. It is
this random other person that is in here.
Yeah.
This random blind disabled child.
Are they doctors as well? Could they check out my children?
You have
the two children? On the floor.
Oh, so there were children.
The two younger ones, yeah.
Oh.
How children are they?
Like teenagers.
Okay.
Early teenagers, yeah.
Sure. Rhiann, could you give them the once over? Just to make sure. They seem okay, but...
Yes, doctor.
Oh, Arnie's going to slap him on the back and be like, yeah, give him the once over.
Did someone say once over?
Not you, little one.
You'll. Sorry, the others are just, you know, tagging along, observing me for the day. The gentleman there's the only real assistant I have.
I see. Please be gentle.
Rhiann will go over to a child.
Okay.
I feel like everything that's been said in the last 5 minutes has sounded
weird. It's getting really weird right now. I'm trying to steer clear. So Nilo, the older elven gentleman, calls out to Ragda, the one that Rhiann is walking over to. Ragda, let the nice man... look at your wounds. Perhaps he can help ease some of the discomfort. This is like, no matter what we do now, it's weird.
Yeah, like, let's just move on.
Let's move on.
Let's move
Rhiann
on.
Rhiann walks over, he checks, he examines, everything's good.
Okay.
Everything is fine.
So, what happened leading up to the attack?
Well, we were tied up. A good number of other prisoners were in cages, and they were our captors were drinking and laughing and, like I said, not very cult-like. They seemed more of the thieving brigand type. And the next thing we knew, we heard a thunderous flapping of wings in the air, and the camp was covered in fire.
Were there any others that got out as you did?
I did not see. I quickly picked up my children and ran as fast as we could in any direction that we could.
Interesting.
Was there, we've met others that were involved, and one of them is looking for their child. Their child had a wooden sword. Did you happen to see that child at all?
I did. Yeah, he was in, it was a small little half-orc or orc boy. I could not tell from my vantage, but he was in one of the cages. Yes. Spry young fellow.
Did you see it all, if he managed to escape, or were the people in the cages not able to get out at all?
I'm afraid I did not. The cages look capable of holding a fairly large beast, so I can't imagine that those prisoners would have escaped.
Why exactly were you not in a cage?
Say again?
Why weren't you in a cage?
There was no room. There was about a dozen or so of us tied up around the campsite, and there were many in both the cages.
So by the time that you arrived, the cages were already full?
Yes.
I see.
Did they mention at all of who they were attempting to sell you off to?
Well, they asked us where we were coming from, what city we were coming from, what we had on us. So I would assume that they would try to ransom us to the towns that we originated from.
Thank you for the information. I'll see about getting the news to.
Can Rhiann insight check? Then.
Can you what check?
Insight check. Actually, yeah.
With a 13, the shakiness that you hear in Nilo's voice is not so much as him holding anything back or fibbing. It's more of fear recalling the events.
I see.
Well, you folks seem... Your injuries aren't too terrible, so I don't know what else I can do, or me and my assistant can do for you at this point. If there's anything else that you could tell us about the incident there that we might be able to tell the town guard, or give any details to any families that we come across, that would be much appreciated.
You see Nilo sort of rub her face and close her, close his eye. Like, I don't know why he's her. I guess Nilo's a weird name. But you see him rubbing his face, trying to remember any sort of detail or anything else. He opens his eyes and puts a finger up. As we were running, we did see a glimpse of a small... I guess you would call them halfling, small halfling, with fiery orange hair. That is about all I can remember, as we were running.
Well, thank you. We will see if we can find that halfling, I suppose.
And then you can hear Ragda sort of, or not Ragda, the other child, Bryngerd. Names. Bryngerd chime.
Daddy, did you tell them about the tall elf, the tall pale elf lady? I saw her too behind the small halfling. I did not see her, Bryngerd. What tall elf lady?
And Bryngerd replies,
she was very pale, and she had her greatsword out, and she looked very scary.
And then Nilo chimes back in. Apparently there was an elf there who was very scary.
Thanks, Dad.
Anyone? Just those two that you remember? Was there also potentially a gnoll-looking fellow, or maybe an orc?
I do not know. All I saw was the little halfling, and apparently my daughter saw a pale elf. Ragda, did you see anything?
No, Papa.
One sec while I control the laughter of that child. Okay, thank you very much. And were they just running from the camp, or were they doing something else?
It looked like they were running towards the dragon.
Okay. Thank you very much. That actually is quite a bit more help than I think you realize.
Thank you.
If any of you have any sort of issues from your injuries and you see me about time, just let me know and I'll check you out again.
But
in the meantime, you seem okay.
Thank you, Doctor. And thank you to your nurses. You will learn a lot from him. He is very good.
He is.
We will be leaving for Dregsvik tonight. So hopefully we will see you before we leave.
Hopefully.
And you see Nilo sort of sink back into the bed, and she motions to her children to go back to sleep.
And Lucas will shuffle out of the room and kind of push everybody with him. And once we got out into the lobby, a red-haired halfling and a scary elf lady.
Facing a dragon?
Well.
That sounds like good old-fashioned friends.
Yeah, it does appear that way. Hopefully they weren't the cause of the dragon going there in the first place.
Hopefully the dragon roasted them.
Yeah, that could also be an outcome.
Oh? People you want dragons to kill? I'm intrigued.
they're not the best of characters, you know. They might have thrown a fireball at us.
They might have tried to frame us.
Was it framing or taking our glory? Both? Actually, it was both.
It was both.
Yeah, it was.
Do you see?
Well, something to keep an eye, yet another thing to keep an eye out for. They're in the area.
All right, well, with that information, we will take our tenor there. All right, so you guys are still in the lobby of, or outside the door.
Oh yeah, with the person that I awkwardly yelled at. Excellent.
She's just sitting there keeping an eye out on you. Or just looking in your direction, continuing folding linens and cloths. What are you guys doing?
I mean, shall we attempt to check in with the Jarl, or do we want to scrounge around town? Don't know that we're going to be able to address the problem with our friends immediately. And the injured people appear to have given all they can.
No, I believe them. I'm just trying to think what would be the best way to go about asking about a curse.
Yeah. I mean, we could see if she just gives it up. We are going to go to her with a request from the Jarl of Endhelon. So true. Maybe if we just say, hey, we're from Endhelon, we're here to help, she'll just spout all her problems at us as everyone else has been doing thus far.
You know, I hadn't really put that together, but now that you point it out, yeah? All right, what could go wrong?
Right on. That's the attitude. What could go wrong?
Woo.
Well, unless anybody has any objections, shall we head to whatever the most important looking building in this town is?
That one up on that hill.
That does seem like the place, yes.
All right, so you guys are heading towards the Jarl's Manor.
I mean, I'll turn to the innkeeper and be like, is the Jarl's Manor the one on top of the hill?
Which hill?
He can't point at it because he's going to point at walls. The largest hill in the town.
Ah, no, that is not the Jarl's Manor. The Jarl's Manor is the one on the smaller hill.
Thank you.
I love the people of this town.
What's on the bigger hill?
That is... Hold on, pull up my notes. That is the Vicland Acer Shrine atop the larger hill.
Oh. Well, good to know.
Yeah, it is of general worship, so all are welcome.
Oh, that sounds interesting.
Yes.
All right. Well, thank you, and I suppose we're off to the smaller hill.
Aww.
All right. So as you traverse the town, you find your way to one of the larger buildings is Svahavn, made of primarily wood with stone accents. The interior is well lit, with a long table in the center of the room. You can see this all from the outside. There are no, like, doors or gates. It's very open layout to what you're used to in Edhelon. Outside of the manor, you can see two of Svahavn's guards, as well as two other guards in different colored clothing. They look to be wearing green and red with an unknown sigil on their person.
Do they look to be discussing anything, or are they just chilling out?
Standing there with their shields and swords in their scabbards. They look to be just keeping watch.
Lucas will approach. Good morning.
Good morning. Wait, which guards are you talking to?
The ones that look like they're Svahavn, the green and white?
Yes, okay.
Yeah, yeah. Good morning. Would it be possible to see the Jarl?
The Jarl is meeting with the Jarl of Dregsvik at the moment. If you would like to try, you may. They are just up the ramp and through those doors.
Oh.
Oh, let's.
Yes. Well, thank you. I assumed there was an appointment required, and he will just start walking.
Lucas, we're in the boondocks. They don't do that.
I'm sorry. I'm used to structure. It's very strange.
Lucas, we need to get you out more.
Oh. I suppose.
All right, so as you make your way up the ramp and through the large opening of the structure, you can see a long table in the center of the room with seating for eight. The Jarl's chair is at the head of the table, a simple wooden chair with a little more wood crafting accents and carvings than the others. At the rear of the building, there's a large stone fireplace hearth with quaint seating scattered about. You can see the Jarl of Svahavn seated at her chair, with the Jarl of Dregsvik seated next to her. Each of the Jarls both flanked by their respective guards. This building and exterior and interior are much less grand than the one seen in Edelon. It's smaller, a little bit more claustrophobic than what you're used to. As you look about above you, you can see a small open balcony area where you can assume that is the living quarters of the Jarl. Shields are emblazoned on the pillars, brandishing the colors of Svahavn, the green and white. What would you guys like to do?
Lucas will approach the table. Are they like actively talking, or are they?
It looks like casual speak right now. You can see them sort of
are
chatting.
They talking over sweet rolls?
there is some sort of spread in front of them, but it doesn't look very very. Aww. It's very rustic.
Before I got an arrow in the knee.
So good in that voice.
It's so bad.
It's beautiful.
So as you approach, the Jarl of Svahavn looks up and gives you a nod and a smile. The Jarl of Dregsvik turns. He stands and gives you a very polite bow. The Svahavn Jarl is a female elf with large green eyes. She's about 6'1", flowing red hair braided on one side of the shoulders. There's a circlet on her head made of wood accented with gold. She has a nose ring. Behind her, to her left, you can see a much larger elf. She has war paint over one eye. The right side of her black hair is wild and unkempt. Left side of her hair is braided behind one ear down to her chest. And you can see that she holds a elvish longsword and longbow affixed on her back. The Jarl of Dregsvik is a large elven male draped in fur. He's clad in scale mail, wearing green and red garb. A circlet of gnarled wood sits atop his black hair. that you're approaching?
Yes.
Okay. She sort of gives you an expected nod.
Lucas will kind of stand sort of at attention and apologies for interrupting your conversation, but my companions and I have traveled from Edhalon at the request of the Jarl there.
Ah, yes, we are. We were expecting you. He sent word that you would be visiting us at some point. How can we be of service?
Well, I suppose, are you up to speed on the events that are happening in the Underthorn?
As far as the Jarl in Edhalon has notified, yes. I assume that you are the heroes of Skalaholt. Is that okay for us to call you that?
You may refer to us as in that manner, yes. I don't know that I see myself as that, but that is what they refer to us as. Others refer to us as the Emerald Dawn.
Very well. I shall...
No!
I shall... refer to you as that, if you so wish.
Appreciated. I'm not certain what specifically the Earl has notified you of, but we seek the assistance of the Jarls in combating the issue in the Underthorn, and to that nature we have come in attempts to resolve any outstanding issues that would prevent you from providing that assistance.
Of course. Yes, he has told me that you are looking to gain the favor of the capital city, and in order to get that favor, you must gain the favor of the warden cities. Am I correct in my assumption?
That is correct.
Very well.
To that nature, we have received reports of mysterious deaths that have happened in Svahavn recently, and we were wondering if there was any way that we could assist with that. That is the only issue that we were aware of that's happening in your town at the moment.
Recent deaths, you must be more specific. There have been, of course, in these parts, there has been crime that I have been trying to, shall I say, stomp out. What recent deaths were you referring to?
More of the mysterious kind, one that might be related to some form of disease. We are uncertain, but there was a victim in Edhalon that mentioned that it originated from Svahavn. So if a victim of crime, their death would seem somewhat straightforward. We're looking more for the mysterious kind.
You could see that she whispers to the larger elf female behind her. Please take note of what he had said. This is the first time I am hearing of mysterious deaths in my town. I am not aware of any rampant diseases in the town either. So this is news to me.
Well, that in itself is reassuring to a degree. Maybe the issue was not as widespread as we once believed.
What about a curse?
Not aware of any curses that have been brought to my attention, at the very least.
Insight check.
Okay. Seventeen. She is very stern in her manner of speaking, and you do not detect any misdirection.
All right.
That aside, you spoke of crime issues. Is there any way that we can assist in order to gain your favor?
Well, the crime is more of thievery and... there have been murders, yes, but the assailants have been captured. And she looks over to the Jarl of Dregsvik, and the larger elf male stands. There, I'm sure you know of the problem with the dragon running rampant throughout these forests, and of course the orc problems that have been plaguing the warden cities around the Eldingvolar.
Yes, we've seen the devastation from the dragon, and we have seen evidence of orc issues as well.
Well, that is something that, if I may, and he looks over to the Svahavn Jarl, if I may, and she agrees, that is something that my city would need help with. If you are so willing.
I see no issue with that, but I would have to consult with the remainder of my party.
Of course.
What specifically, so we're already aware of the dragons. Is there a particular orc band in the area that you need dealt with?
Well, it seems in these forests we can only deal with one thing at a time, being that most of our resources are very bare. We can only deal with one or the other in terms of the orcs and the dragon. In terms of the orcs, they have been increasing in numbers, and their raids have also been increasing in intensity within the forest. They have been menacing many of the smaller villages in the Kveldstjarne forest. And of course, in terms of the dragon, it has made its lair near the town of Grimwick. And we fear that the dragon might turn its eyes to our cities.
Very well. And he'll like turn around and look at the party to see what they're thinking.
Rhiann's gonna nod.
Stoically.
Do we have any preference? I imagine the dragon is the greater of the two threats, and also we have an interest in dealing with it. More than one, perhaps.
We do, and you know, I've always wanted to see a dragon up close.
I don't know that I share that desire, but it would be interesting nonetheless.
And who knows what a dragon would have in its lair?
Indeed. Also, the spears have been moving about in the area. Are they having trouble keeping the orcs in check?
The Jarl of Svahavn chimes in. My rangers have spotted their movements within the forest, mostly headed north. Not 4 days ago, perhaps related to the orc raids, or maybe something greater. We tend not to meddle in the working of the spears, lest we incur their wrath.
Understandable.
We of course pride ourselves in our ability to fight, but not against such a force. Anyone in these lands would be foolish to go toe to toe with an obsidian spear.
Wise guidance. Very well, it appears that unless there are any additional objections from my party, we will pursue the dragon. And leave the orcs to your teams? I believe that is what you were indicating.
The Jarl of Dregsvik speaks up. Oh, my apologies. My name is... this way, I don't have to keep saying Jarl of. My name is Jarl Jorik Oakhart of Dregsvik. Well, we sort of had a plan to perhaps, as you say, kill two birds with one stone.
I'm all ears.
In terms of the dragon and the orcs. Our scouts have told us that the orcs have made camp somewhere north of the village of Grimwick. Perhaps, I was speaking with my elders, perhaps there is a way that we can turn the dragon's ire towards this growing number of orcs.
Oh, I like that idea. Did you have an idea in mind?
We were thinking maybe finding a way to implicate the orcs in the destruction of the dragon's eggs and whatever offspring she may have already laid.
Does this mean that you are planning on destroying the dragon's eggs?
Indeed. But of course, that would draw the wrath of the dragon towards us.
So you're saying you want us to do it?
Yes. If you wish the favor of Dregsvik, it would be much appreciated. Of course, we do not have the resources to do it ourselves, or we would have done it already.
Very well. We will attempt to do that. I'm not specific. Do you have a method for us to somehow pin it on the orcs, or is this just a hoping for the best type of situation?
A little bit of both. Perhaps maybe leaving orc clothing or weapons behind. The elders have fashioned, and he calls to the guard directly behind him. The guard walks over and lays down a rather large satchel on the table. Second. So as he unfurls the cloth on the satchel, you can see a few pairs of what look to be orc molds, orc foot molds, made out of plaster and dirt. They're attached to 2-foot-long slats of wood and secured with leather strappings. Perhaps this may help in implicating the orcs, showing their tracks instead of human or elven tracks.
You mean we would Bigfoot them?
I do not know what you mean by Bigfoot, but these are big feet, and
we're gonna Scooby-Doo this shit.
I appreciate the idea. We will do our best to implement it. He will just put the mold in the bag of holding, I guess.
Okay.
Looking very quizzically on that, like, how the fuck would I walk on these? And like, uh, but we will also try other methods as well. It seems a bit dangerous just to rely on that.
Whatever idea you can come up with would be most welcome, as long as we can kill these two birds with one stone.
Well, does turning the eyes of the dragon on the orcs, does that actually solve the dragon problem?
For the time being, it would definitely buy us some time, at the very least, to evacuate the villages around that area and get them to Dregsvik.
Well, it looks like the request is not necessarily for a dead dragon, so that does make it slightly easier.
If you were able to kill the dragon, even the more better. But this would be, as you say, the easier route. At least buying us some time so we can gather the resources to do such killing.
Very well. We will do our best. And I'm assuming that Svahavn feels the same way in regards to us earning your trust?
The dragon is mostly out of our area. The orcs, however, they have been causing us some trouble. So I would tend to agree that yes. This would definitely relieve both our cities of our problems, our immediate problems, and garner you the favor of both cities.
That would bring the dragon closer to one of these cities, would that be? Perhaps foolhardy?
Say that again, I'm sorry, I was drinking water.
Would bringing the dragon closer to your city in the manner of, well, hacking the orcs, would that perhaps be concerning?
That is a concern, but it is the best hope that we have in terms of dealing with both. Again, like the Jarl Yorick has stated, it would at the very least buy us some time to gather the resources needed either to kill this dragon or evacuate whatever we can. Most of the smaller villages would be better protected in one of the warden cities.
I see.
Well, unless anybody has anything else, shall we begin our work?
It sounds like a plan. We need to go to Dregsvik anyway.
Alrighty. Thank you for your time. We will hopefully return with good news.
We wish you all the luck. If there's anything you need from my city, just let me know, and I will see what I can do to assist you in your quest.
Thank you. Lucas will turn and head out.
To the west.
All right. So as you guys make your way out of the town of Svahavn, the Jarl of Dregsvik also gave you a rough drawing, barely usable map of the area in which they think that the dragon has made its lair.
Alrighty.
So you can see on the map that there is a X marked near the town of Grimwick, a little bit to the north, and a smaller X, it says Broken Tower, slightly to the right of the larger X.
Okie dokie.
So you guys headed to Dregsvik or Grimwick?
Well, Dregsvik would be on the way and we can check for refugees.
Aha. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Our quest to find the child.
This is our real quest.
Alright, so the trek is going to be a little over 2 traveling days to Dregsvik. You begin making your way to the west towards Dregsvik. Who is in the front?
Probably Arnie.
Okay. Make a perception check or survival, either or.
Gonna navigate the fuck out of this forest.
Oh, yeah. 18. All right, so.
Bitch, I'm a ranger!
In her what I do!
In her favored terrain.
It's kind of her thing.
Yes. All right. So you guys make your way the first leg of the trip. Oh, hold on. What time is it now? It is... Seven, eight, nine. Let's say it's about 11 a.m.
Perfect.
From the time you left Svahavn. So you travel 8 hours. Four. And you set up for camp for the first leg of the trip.
Although for while we're traveling during the day, Arnie wants to bring up with the group. So are we really down with killing baby dragons?
I cannot say that the idea makes me very comfortable.
I personally am not a fan.
I would also agree. There were multiple issues with that particular plan. But at the same time, I don't really know what to do to solve that problem.
I've got some ideas.
Oh?
Well, it depends on what route you want to go. If we still want the dragon to attack the orcs and have one of them eliminate the other, and there's a couple of different things we could do. We could simply try to take something else of value from its hoard and just plant it in the orc camp. It should be able to follow the scent and figure that out on its own. Another option, slightly more complex but could have interesting results, would be we make it look like orcs tried to kill the dragon's young. But we killed the orcs instead, perhaps earning the dragon's favor, and we could just ask it to leave.
Ooh, that is a very risky option that sounds like we end up fighting a dragon.
But it could turn out to be really, really grateful and we have the favor of a dragon then. You don't know.
True. That is very true.
Dragons are highly intelligent.
Exactly.
I feel like we're forgetting this.
God, is it well known that dragons are highly intelligent?
Yes. It is very well known that, dragons are highly intelligent.
Also sentient.
Yes.
So they want to kill sentient baby.
This is why we're against killing the sentient baby.
Okay.
Yeah. Killing.
This is why we're not okay.
If we could just ask the dragon to go somewhere else, that'd be great.
In none of the scenarios I listed, do the babies die?
Yep.
Now, those two lead with the initial plan of getting the dragon to attack the orcs. But if we want to avoid doing that altogether, then we probably have to look more into why the orcs are in this area.
Or perhaps why the dragon's in this area?
Well, if she has young, I'm assuming it's because she found a safe place to hatch them. So she's not leaving until her babies can leave with her.
And also, more importantly, regarding the dragons, anywhere where our friends are, probably not the best situation, and probably whatever they're going after is most likely a victim so much instead of a perpetrator.
That's a good point.
So well, something
I'm just happy that none of us want to kill baby dragons here. I was a little concerned.
We did need to keep up appearances in front of the jarls. We couldn't.
Oh, really... I agree. I understood. Just double checking.
Yeah.
As soon as I heard baby dragon killing, I totally zoned out.
Well, I think as long as all of us are on the same page. What is the safer option here?
First,
because if we do, in fact, deceive the dragon into thinking that we saved its eggs, well, what do we do with the orcs?
It depends. I mean, if we observe the dragon and the dragon seems like it really is just trying to protect its brood and nothing more, then maybe we could make it realize that the orcs are a threat to that.
So does everything here hinge on the idea that hinge on what the dragon's intentions are?
So far, we've only seen it kill a bandit camp, potentially slash cultists, but apparently not.
Well, so might I suggest that we treat that as step one, and then figure it out from there.
Mm-hmm. I got that.
I like your brain.
I like it too. It feels nice in my head.
You could feel your brain?
You cannot?
I don't think you're supposed to be able to.
Have you ever had a headache?
I think that's your blood vessels, though.
Are those blood vessels not in your brain?
Well, I mean, you got some on your skin and your skull, too. That's not inside your brain.
That's true.
Is this one of those situations where, like, you breathe uncontrollably and suddenly become aware of it, and now you're breathing manually, and now you're aware of your brain, and now you feel...
Are you now aware of your brain and how it feels inside of your head?
Explodes.
Lila,
your nose is always in view.
Yeah, it scares me too a little bit sometimes.
I like your brain. I like where it is.
Aw, I like it in my head too.
It's quite nice, isn't it?
Yeah, I do agree on the headache thing though. When it's trying to push out of your skull, it's not a good feeling. But anywho, dragon intention finding?
Sounds like a plan.
Okay. So as you set up camp for the night. Nope, not for the night, but for the first leg of the trip. Who's taking first watch?
I guess Lucas can.
I guess Lilac can as well. I'm assuming she passed out drunk somewhere in there, so she's not that tired.
Happens.
She got a drunk nap in.
She got carried.
Yeah.
All right, as you settle in to rest your bones from the first leg of the journey, the first watch begins. What do you talk about?
Well, I'm guessing that right away there's going to be something to do with some polishing of some kind.
That just always happens.
Yeah. So there's polishing going on.
That's understood.
And while Lucas is keeping to himself and doing his things, Lilac is kind of off to the side, also doing her own things, although her things seem to involve staring wistfully into a large orb that she has hoisted from her belt. Kind of just chilling there. Also kind of polishing it lightly, but maybe not the same way Lucas is used to polishing things.
Lucas will take note of that. What significance does that have to you, Lilac?
What? Oh, this? Yeah. Oh, it's just this. No, it's just, I don't really know how to explain it, honestly.
Well, does it do anything for you, or?
Yeah, it's my friend. Sort of.
Your friend?
Yeah.
It's an interesting way to describe an orb. It's nothing like Dahlia, is it, right? It's not going to pop out at any moment.
Honestly, I wish. Sometimes. But no.
Okay. Well, that's good. I mean, she's in her orb right now, so I guess it wouldn't be too shocking if something else popped out.
No, that wouldn't shock you at all. Not even a little spook.
I'd actually be quite shocked and, you know, potentially ready to fight whatever it is.
Yeah, especially now knowing what we know.
Yeah, I mean, the orb's not, it's not black or green, right?
Lilacs?
Yes.
Yeah, no, it's a kind of like an interesting crystal ball looking type thing.
Okay. Well, it's not black or green, so that's a great start to the introduction of any orb to this party.
No, it doesn't have just those colors. It has lots of other colors, usually.
Lots of other colors, you say?
Yeah, it kind of eats them, like, just gobbles them up. And she'll do like a weird little like claw hand motion to go along with her words.
Wow.
Nom nom nom.
That is rather interesting. he's looking at that orb. Seeing what he can piece together about what she means by gobbling up colors.
Well, I will say, I don't know. I don't know that I would have told you what this is.
Nope.
But it
good opportunity to reveal.
Yeah. But it's just her, from what you would know as a priest, with your own focus, it is just her arcane focus, from what you can tell. Kind of has that vibe for some reason to you.
Okay.
But yeah, that's probably all you
There's
would
nothing
really know.
That indicates anything about a friend. It's just...
Yeah, it's probably just a weird Wadlack speak. But you do notice that every now and then, like when you're looking at it, it does swirl a little bit with, you know, occasional little bouts of color here and there, like little pastel color swirls.
Okay. So, I mean, you've mentioned Silver Mother's role in your upbringing, but I'm assuming your friend also has something to do with it?
Oh, yes, yes. This one's been with me, well, much longer than Silver Mother has. Just kind of gaze off wistfully.
Well, don't mean to pry too much into these types of things, but I hope everything's okay with that. You do seem to rather excitable at times, and it's not your friend talking to you, is it? Or is that just Lilac?
That's just probably Lilac. No.
Good to hear.
Yeah.
It is interesting, you know. Watching you go, you know, the first day or so that I met you, finding out you were blind was honestly a shock to me with how well you moved about. So, I don't really know. I'm just, learning more about you is very interesting.
Aw, well, I shall, like, you see, like, the vaguest hint of what might be a blush on her very kind of dullish gray skin. She just kind of looks down at her lap. Well, that's oddly nice. I'm not used to people being interested in my things or asking me questions or giving me compliments, so thank you.
Oh, well, my pleasure. I mean, we're traveling together, and again, like, you are definitely an interesting character. I'm shocked that you haven't experienced more of it in the past. Also, your ringlets. They're quite adorable.
And now you see a full-blown blush. She'll, like, touch one. Like, it's strange to her to feel that it's in a shape that's not just completely disheveled. Oh, you think so?
I would actually... Is that their natural state? Because I'll be quite honest with you, Lilac. When we first met, you were a bit out of sorts. But once she cleaned you up, they just immediately appeared that way.
Well, shucks. Well, I actually don't know. I guess I've never actually smelled them this way before or felt them this way, so maybe it's how they're supposed to be.
That or Dolly is a fantastic hairdresser.
I'm sure that's also true, yes.
Lucas doesn't know what to talk about. He's just polishing at this point.
Lilac is actually going to. Her bat has, during the course of this conversation, kind of fluttered down and been chilling nearby, staring at you while you're putzing with your armor. And after an awkward pause, she's gonna chime up in bat voice. So, what about you? Do you have a special relationship with your armor?
No.
Well, you seem to love it so much. You take such good care of it.
Yes. The teachings. I've had my entire life, actually. The teachings of Helm. One of the major tenets of it is always take good care of your equipment, because in battle, that's your best chance at survival. So it's just, you could call it good advice, you could call it a religious ritual. Either is appropriate in this case.
I see. Well, what about if, say, you're trying to sneak by some scary guys and your armor's so bright and shiny that it catches in the sun and it gives you away?
That is a risk I take. But to be fair, I am quite aware that I am not the stealthiest of characters. So I try to let others go forward in those types of cases. It is what it is.
Oh, I guess I'm unfamiliar with the whole, you know, charging forward into battle thing.
I wouldn't say I really do that either. It's generally, when you're responsible for making sure everyone's healthy, charging headlong into battle with no regard for anything else is also a bad idea. So,
what else do you do then? You're not sneaking or charging?
I try to address the situation appropriately and, you know, take the appropriate tactical approach than just either hiding or running straight in.
Oh, you're talking about words.
Also that, yes. Those are great to start. If we don't have to fight, that's ideal. But at the same time, in our line of business, you tend to end up fighting.
So you do charge in then?
If you're asking if I am not afraid to knock some heads, the answer is yes. I am not afraid to knock some heads.
She nods very happily at this. She seemed a little confused up until that moment.
Yeah, sorry. It's, priestly order and all. Do no harm until you kind of have to do harm.
Yeah, that makes zero sense to me.
You know what? Now I think about it, it also kind of makes zero sense to me as well. Oh, well.
We both learned something. Yay!
Yay!
She'll just very awkwardly and abruptly go back to staring into her orb.
Yes, and Lucas is also awkwardly continuing to maintain his armor.
Okay.
Perfect.
So as you have your backs sort of turned away from each other, the first watch has ended. It is now around 11 p.m. at night. Who are you guys waking up? I guess you're just gonna go to the tents of the only other two people. Wake them up.
Yeah.
Unless somebody wants to do watch with the silent Dahlia.
Yeah.
Dahlia's in her orb. She's gone. Right. Well, Lilac's gonna waddle over and just,
psst, there's a portal, oh my gosh!
And in Arnie's ear.
Oh, Arnie's arm is gonna fly up and smack her. Reflex.
She'll just fall over, like, with a thud.
Ow!
Lilac, what the fuck?
That's not very nice. I was warning you of impending danger.
You whispered in my ear when I was asleep.
Yeah. that not how you warn sleeping people? Some people don't, but I'll take note that you do. Gosh.
Just like rubber head.
Anyway, it's your turn for watch.
Lilac. Okay. Maybe just don't do that next time.
Yeah, noted.
And Lucas will walk up to Rhiann, who I assume is sitting next to a tree.
Stoically.
Stoically sitting next to a tree.
Eyes open, sleeping.
Yeah.
Yes. Gandalf sit.
Rhiann.
Ah, I don't know. Have a good sleep.
I'm sorry?
Have a good sleep.
Ah, yes. Thank you. And Lucas will not go into a tent, and he will take his prayer books and kind of walk off into the woods.
Ooh. Or he can do that.
Bye, Lucas.
I mean, he could sit next to trees. Lucas could sit next to trees.
You're laughing at Lucas walking into the darkness.
Yeah.
He needs a dark tree.
Yes.
More like some privacy, God. Give the guy his prayer space.
All right. Second watch has begun. What are you two talking about, and what is Lucas doing?
Lucas is off in the woods right now, so they can talk.
Okay.
Rhiann will happily sit quietly by the fire.
Arnie's just very clearly fidgeting with her bow, trying to entertain herself and failing. Until she finally looks over at Rhiann and cracks and just goes, "Hey, so, did you always grow up in Viklin?"
I was not from around Viklin originally, but, through various circumstances, you could say I washed up.
I thought so. Your accent didn't match.
Ah. Yes, I would have picked up my manner of speaking from the company that I kept, shall we say.
So where did you, quote, wash up from? Is it far away?
To be honest, I'm not quite sure. I spent most of my early days on the boat. I was taken from my parents at a young age.
Was it like a fishing boat? Were you working? What was?
Not quite.
Were you a pirate?
Also not quite. I was a slave, shall we say. I was being prepared to be a slave.
Oh. I'm really sorry. I didn't mean to.
It's all right. It is a part of my past. One cannot run from it.
Not run from it, huh?
Well, one cannot run from that happened.
No.
There is plenty of room from running from your circumstances.
You have a big world out there.
Right. But, yes, I was once a boy on a slave ship. And, well, through one means or another, I escaped that life. And he'll pull his, whatever you call it, his gi aside a little bit
And you'll see, like, starting from, well, just where his back starts, you'll see a large number of crisscrossing scars that are clearly very, very old. And then he'll put it back. There is much room to run from your circumstances, as I assume you are aware of.
Oh, yeah. But what happened to you? That's disgusting, people. Are they dead? Did you kill them?
I cannot say that I was able to kill them quite yet. I was quite young. No. It was just far larger. Perhaps at the time, impossible.
Well, maybe in the future, we can all take a field trip and make some corpses.
Perhaps. I do not tend to look that far. It is not... The new way of life that I have found does not reflect my old.
Thank goodness for that. Work.
Most of it.
Still. Those kinds of people make me sick.
They make you sick to be near as well. They smell quite a bit.
I'm sure most people stuck on boats do.
Though, to be fair, I did hear that the benefactor was quite a rich man. I was only familiar with the boats, but there were many more that I did not see.
Did you know the name of the benefactor?
I did not. The ship's captain. Well, he did not consider me worthy of hearing his name, clearly. All we know is that he was a man that it did indeed scare him as well.
I hope they both get choked by octopuses.
That would be quite poetic.
Wouldn't it just?
I will say, what I do know of the man was that he was from the east in what sounded like a desert. We could never reach quite where he was, but I know a number of, well, not friends, but other meat, as they say, were sold off there.
They literally called you meat?
Yes, among other things. Again, I have shed that, and, clearly that is not what I considered myself.
Oh no, you'd never be that. But it just pisses me off.
Well, I appreciate it. It is. But I am lucky that I was lucky that I was able to get away at all.
I just can't believe you managed to get away as a child.
It was a matter of a bit of luck and circumstance and, well, stormy weather.
Hmm.
I believe that Thor himself came to liberate me. And whether or not that is actually true, that is, well, the way of the storm is my way of saying things.
You know, that's a nice way of putting it. You know? It might be cheesy, but honestly, you're a pretty damn strong person to be able to just put that behind you.
Part of me believes that it is out of necessity. I don't believe that I would have survived. Well, frankly, I'm not terribly sure how many years, but many years. I was not able to put yesterday behind me.
I suppose not, but still, most people can't.
There are many bodies on the seafloor that would agree with you.
I'm sure the ocean's always hungry.
At some point it feels very welcoming, let me tell you. Friendly, if cold.
You know, I've never seen the ocean.
Talia said the same thing. It may be good for us to take a trip there. Very beautiful.
Now that would be fun.
But of course, I was stationed out here to protect this land. But the coast is very, very nice. Especially nice around the summer. The waves are perfectly light blue.
We should all go. I mean, what's life without a little slacking off for fun?
I agree. It's not everyone's lot in life to be able to take a moment and relax. I believe that is very healing.
Yeah. We just have to convince Lucas.
I believe that he would need to hide his armor. It salt water can be quite corrosive.
Oh god, if it rusted, I think he'd lose his mind.
I do believe he feels quite naked without it.
Literally or metaphorically?
Possibly both. He does seem like a man that cannot put yesterday behind him.
No. No, he doesn't.
Not that I believe that this is the only way to live. I certainly believe that there is great need for men like him. But
no, he's a good person for sure. But sometimes I get the vibe he's trying to, I don't know, be someone he's not.
Seems a bit tiring. I agree.
Now, one day at a time, I suppose.
Indeed. Look to tomorrow.
Okay. The second watch begins coming to a close as you sit around the campfire. You continue conversation, small talk. Meanwhile, Lilac. In your sleep, you hear the familiar triple voice in your head. Lilac, my dear. Are you well?
Mother?
Yes, yes. How is my little lilac?
I'm exploring the world, like you said. I'm doing good.
Have you been collecting trinkets for me?
Oh, yes.
That is good to hear. If you enjoy your powers, continue doing that.
I will do as you say, Mother.
There is something I want you to look into, Lilac.
Yes?
You ran into these creatures before, within the Lockwood, where I found you. The Duragar, the Grey Dwarves of Nidavellir. They took something from me.
And do you want it back?
I do. Find them. Call on me when you have found them. They have something I want.
All right, Mother, I'll get right on that.
Very good, little lilac. Be well. And the voices subside. And that's where we'll end it.